وصلي وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين أما بعد. Welcome back to what is the launch of Quranic Progression Year 2. I hope you've all had a long enjoyable summer, the break that we had. And for those of you that did take the exam last week, Jazakallah khair for taking the exam. The exam is an important part of what we're trying to do here, because it is something which inshallah will help you revise and refresh and remember the knowledge that was given and the information that we've all learned and the tafsir that we've studied. And going ahead, inshallah, it's something which gets us back into the tafsir mode, right, ready for year two, inshallah ta'ala. For those of you that deferred the exam, weren't able to take the exam last week, you have one final opportunity this weekend coming. So inshallah, on this weekend, you'll have that opportunity to do so. For those of you that did take the exam last weekend, you weren't able to go and access your results in terms of seeing what were the correct and incorrect answers and where you went right and where you went wrong. So inshallah, that's something which which will be available also this weekend. So if you've taken the exam and you want to go back and check your paper and see where maybe you went wrong or the errors that you made and so on, you'll inshallah be able to do that also from this weekend. However, for those of you who haven't taken the exam, I would encourage you inshallah this weekend to take that deferred exam. And then inshallah next week we'll go through some of those questions inshallah. I think there were like 50 questions, so we probably can't do all of them, but we'll go through some of them inshallah, and we'll go over like a brief recap. So onwards and upwards, we come to the next surah in our tafsir, and that is the tafsir of Surah Quraysh. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this surah, and this is a Makki surah according to the vast majority of the scholars of Islam, it has a number of names by which it is known. Imam Ibn Kathir rahimahullah ta'ala, he says, and he calls it Surah Li'ilafi Quraysh, using the first verse. And as we mentioned last year, this is a very common way in which the scholars of tafsir speak about surahs. They will often refer to surahs using the first verse, or using a part of the first verse if that first verse is very long. So this is one of those examples, Surah Al-Ilafi Quraysh, and it is mentioned by this name, meaning it is mentioned as narrations using this name, the Ilafi Quraysh, and a number of the famous scholars were the past and companions, not least of them Abdullah ibn Abbas radiyallahu anhuma, that he would refer to this surah as Surah Li'ilafi Quraysh. And is also reported as narrated on him by Al-Imam Al-Hassan Al-Basri rahimahullah ta'ala and Al-Imam Al-Zuhri. Imam Al-Zuhri rahimahullah. That they would refer to this surah as Surah Li'ilafi Quraysh. The other name that is also known by is Surah Li'ilafi. So just taking the first word of the first verse. And the third name that it is known by is Surah Quraysh. And that's probably in our times the most common and the most famous name that this surah is referred to, Surah Quraysh. So it has three names, the full verse, Li'ilafi Quraysh, the first word of the verse, Li'ilafi, and then the final word of that verse, Surah Quraysh. It is a Makki surah in the opinion of the vast majority of the scholars of Islam, Ibn Abbas, radiyallahu anhuma, Ikrima, Al-Hassan, Qatada, and from the scholars of Tafsir, Ibn Kathir, Al-Baghawi, Al-Suyuti, and others, they said that it is a Makki surah, meaning that it was revealed before Hijrah, revealed before the Hijrah. And Imam Ibn Atiyah, rahimahullah, in his Tafsir, he said, هي مكية بلا خلاف. There is no difference of opinion that this surah is Makki. However, it is mentioned on some of the scholars of Tafsir, like Al-Dhahak and Al-Kalbi, that they said that the surah was a Madani surah. So those two scholars of Tafsir, it is reported on them that they said that it is a Madani surah. But the vast majority of the scholars, and as we've heard, some of them even said it is ijma', a point of agreement and consensus, that the surah is Makki, and that seems to be the strongest of the opinions, and Allah Azza wa Jalla knows best. It consists of four ayahs, as we know, and it is the only surah in the Quran that in which a tribe is named. In which a tribe is named. There is no other part of the Quran, no other surah or verse in which the name of a tribe is given. So the name of nations is mentioned, like Ad and Thamud and Midian and Bani Israel and so on. But the names of tribes are not mentioned in the Quran except for the tribe of Quraysh in this surah. And that is to show obviously the importance of Quraysh and its status and its virtue and its religion, and also to show the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's status as well, because he comes from the tribe of Quraysh. In the hadith of Ummu Hanif bin Talib radiyallahu anha, she is the sister of Ali radiyallahu anhu, that the Prophet said sallallahu alaihi wasallam, فضل الله قريشا بسبع خلال. Allah Azza wa Jal gave virtue, superiority, preference to Quraysh by seven things. Number one, أني منهم, that I am from them. So Allah gave virtue and status to Quraysh, that He made me from them, number one. Number two, وَأَنَّ النُّبُوَّةَ فِيهِمْ, and that He placed prophethood within them, meaning that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, number one, that he is from Quraysh, number two, that he became a prophet and that prophethood therefore is with them. Number three, الْحِجَابَةَ وَالسِّقَايَةُ, الْحِجَابَةُ وَالسِّقَايَةُ فِيهِمْ, three and four, الْحِجَابَ and السِّقَايَ are amongst them. What is hijaba? Anyone know? And the siqaya? What were the Quraysh famous for?
Poetry.
Poetry? No. No. The Arabs were all famous for poetry. But what were Quraysh known for?
Hospitality.
Okay, hospitality, and more specifically, what type of hospitality?
To the judge.
Yeah. So what's siqaya? Siqaya is to water the pilgrims. Right? Min as-saqa. Istisqa is the prayer that we seek rain, right? Seek water. Siqaya is watering the pilgrims, and this was the role given to the family of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Banu Hashim and Banu Muttalib. They were the people who were responsible amongst Quraysh in providing water for the pilgrims. And I think last year we mentioned the story of Abdul Muttalib and how he discovered Zamzam and so on. So did we?
Yes.
I just made that up.
No, we did.
We did not.
We did.
Okay, we did. Alhamdulillah. Anyway, so it's there somewhere in those 50 odd videos last year. So so siqaya was given to the family of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That's siqaya. What is hijaba? Al-hijaba. What does that refer to? It's also similar in the same kind of line of thinking.
Sheltering.
Sorry?
Sheltering, no.
It's also something to do with the Kaaba and the Hajj and so on. Al-hijaba?
Tijara.
Tijara, no, not business. Hijaba refers to looking after the haram, the Kaaba. So the upkeeping of the Kaaba and the opening of the Kaaba and all of that stuff, right? And that's why in the hadith, in the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he conquered Mecca and he called Uthman ibn Talha. Uthman ibn Talha was who? No. Uthman ibn Talha.
Given the keys.
Is the man who held the key from which tribe, which clan of Quraysh? Banu. No. Banu Shayba. Banu Shayba is the clan that was responsible for holding the keys of the Kaaba, right? And it is also known by another name as Sadana. Sadanatul Bayt, right? Sadana is the people who hold the key of the Kaaba. So the Prophet ﷺ called Uthman ibn Talha, and he had the keys. He took the keys from him because he obviously went and emptied the Kaaba out of its idols and so on. And then the Prophet ﷺ also prayed in the Kaaba. And whilst he had the keys in his hands, Al-Abbas and the people had gathered. All of them had gathered, the Muslims and the non-Muslims, Quraysh had gathered around the Prophet ﷺ. The uncle Al-Abbas radiyallahu anhu and Ali ibn Abi Talib radiyallahu anhuma, both of them came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and they said, O Messenger of Allah, let us be from those who only not only have the siqaya, but we have the hijaba as well. Meaning, give to us not only the honor of watering the pilgrims, but give us the honor of the upkeep of the Kaaba. Right? Because Quraysh, this is how their different families and their clans knew their status and their superiority. And the two highest positions were these two positions, right? The people who used to have the siqaya and used to have the hijaba. The people who had the upkeep of the Kaaba, and the people who would give water to the pilgrims, and they would feed the pilgrims. So they said, and this is the uncle of the Prophet ﷺ and his son-in-law, his first cousin, they come to him and they say, O Messenger of Allah, make the siqaya and the hijaba amongst us, give it both to us. The Prophet ﷺ called Uthman ibn Talha. And Uthman ibn Talha, by the way, is the same man who before the Prophet ﷺ migrated to Medina, in the early days of Mecca, the Prophet ﷺ came to him one day and asked him for the keys of the Kaaba so that he could go and pray inside the Kaaba. And it was the custom of that time that if one of the Quraysh asked for the key, they would open the door for someone from Quraysh. If you were outside of Quraysh, you weren't able to go and request the key of the Kaaba and go and pray. But for the Quraysh, this was something which they used to do. They used to open the key, the door of the Kaaba, so someone could go in and pray. The Prophet ﷺ asked him to do so and he said, no. He said, no, I refuse. So the Prophet ﷺ said to him, perhaps a day will come when I will have the key in my hand and I will give it to whomsoever I please. And the Prophet Uthman ibn Talha said to the Prophet ﷺ, if such a day ever occurs, it will be the most humiliating of days, right? It's the worst of days. He's a non-Muslim and this is like the early days of Islam. That's like the worst of days. If that ever happens, that the keys are in your hand, you choose who to give it to, it will be one of the worst days. The Prophet ﷺ said no, but rather it will be one of the most honorable days. So many years later, this is what's taking place, right? The Prophet ﷺ now has the keys. Uthman ibn Talha has no power, has no influence, has no right to demand the keys back. The Prophet ﷺ called him and he said, خُذُوهَا بَنِي شَيْبَ خَالِدَةً تَالِدَةً لَا يَنْسِعُهَا مِنْكُمْ إِلَّا ظَالِمٌ. Take it, O family of Banu Shaybah, forever, for eternity. No one will take it from you except an oppressor. So he gave the key back to Uthman ibn Talha and to keep in his family of Banu Shaybah. And that is why from that time until today, that key has descended from generation to generation in the same tribe of Banu Shaybah, in the same descendants of that same family. Even in our time today, the key is held by the eldest member of that family. The eldest member of that family, and when he passes away, it is given to the next eldest member. And that's why when the Saudi government, when they open up the Kaaba to clean it, or someone comes to pray in it, they ask them to bring the key, and they open the door of the Kaaba for them. So that is something which has lasted from that statement of the Prophet ﷺ, no one will remove it from you except a zalim, except someone who is an oppressor. So the point is that this is the hadith, right? The Prophet ﷺ is saying that Quraysh were given seven special attributes. Number one, that I am from them. Number two, that prophethood is from them. Number three, that they have the upkeep of the Kaaba. Number four, that they water the pilgrims. Number five, وَأَنَّ اللَّهَ نَصَرَهُمْ عَلَى الْفِيلِ, that Allah gave them victory over the army of the elephants. That's number five. Number six, وَأَنَّهُمْ عَبَدُوا اللَّهَ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ عَشْرَ سِنِينَ لَا يَعْبُدُهُ غَيْرُهُمْ, and that they worshipped Allah in a period of history for 10 years at a time when no one else worshipped Him. Only they worshipped Allah Azza wa Jal. وَأَنَّ اللَّهَ أَنزَلَ فِيهِمْ سُورَةٌ مِّنَ الْقُرْآنِ. And number 10, and that Allah revealed about them a surah in the Qur'an. Number 7, sorry. And that Allah revealed about them a surah in the Qur'an. And then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam recited this surah, Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, لِإِلَافِ قُرَيْشِ إِلَافِهِمْ رِحْلَةَ الشِّتَاءِ وَالصَّيْفِ فَلْيَعْبُدُوا رَبَّ هَذَا الْبَيْتِ الَّذِي أَطْعَمَهُمْ مِنْ جُوعٍ وَآمَنَهُمْ مِنْ خَوْفٍ. This hadith is collected in al-Tabarani and al-Hakim and is mustadrak. And Imam al-Hakim said that it is authentic, but this is a hadith, one of those hadith that the scholars differed greatly over. Al-Hafidh al-Iraqi said that it is Hassan, Shaykh al-Albani said that it is Hassan, but other scholars like Imam al-Dhahabi and others said that it is extremely weak. Right? And Imam al-Dhahabi said about one of the narrators of this hadith, the narrator is known for saying things which are manakir, which are rejected. And he said this hadith is from those examples. So there is a difference of opinion amongst the scholars as to the authenticity or lack thereof. But as we said, a number of those scholars said that it is a hadith which is acceptable, it is hasan. The point of this hadith either way is to show that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave certain virtues to the people of Quraysh. Not least of them is this virtue. And that Allah azza wa jal mentions them by name in the Quran, whereas no other tribe is mentioned in that way in the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. One of the interesting discussions that the scholars of tafsir have concerning this surah is whether this surah is a surah that is independent of the surah that is before it, or whether there are two surahs, whether there are two surahs independent of each other, or whether they are one surah and those two surahs are actually one. Right? And even though today it's not really a debate anymore because we can't know that there are two surahs, but in the time of the companions and the Salaf, it was something which was debated by them. So the surah obviously that we're referring to before is which one? Suratul Fil, right? The surah of the elephant. And there is no doubt, as a number of the scholars have mentioned, that thematically the two surahs have a very close relationship. Because Surah Al-Fil is the surah in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about Allah azza wa jal saving Quraysh and the Kaaba and Mecca from the army of the elephant. Right? And that's one of the great blessings that Allah bestowed upon the people of Quraysh. And then in Surah Quraysh, Allah azza wa jal speaks about further blessings that He gave to the tribe of Quraysh. So no doubt there is a close link between the two surahs. So even those scholars, and they are the majority of the scholars who said that they are two independent surahs, right? There are two independent surahs. Surah Al-Fil is a surah in its own right, and Surah Quraysh is a surah in its own right. There is no doubt they are thematically, in terms of content and message, and the theme that is discussed, they are extremely close. Both of them have an overlap. So it is reported that some of the companions and some of the scholars of the past used to say that they are one surah. From those companions is the famous companion and the scholar of the Quran, Ubay ibn Ka'ab, radiyallahu anhu. Ubay ibn Ka'ab used to, it is said that in his mushaf that he kept for himself, there was no fasil, there was no basmala, there was no bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim between the two surahs, and he would consider them to be one. And Sufyan ibn Uyayna, rahimahullah, is one of the famous scholars of the past. He said, كَانَ لَنَا إِمَامٌ لَا يَفْصِلُ بَيْنَهُمَا. We used to have an imam who, when he would recite, he wouldn't separate between the two. When they say separate between the two, what does that mean? How do you separate? With the basmala, right? So when they say there's no separation, what's he saying? He's saying, فَجَعَلَكُمْ كَعَصْفٍ مَأْكُولٍ لِإِلَافِ قُرَيْشِ. Whereas if you were to separate, what would he say? فَجَعَلَهُمْ كَعَصْفٍ مَأْكُولٍ بِسْمِ اللَّهِ الرَّحْمَنِ الرَّحِيمِ لِإِلَافِ قُرَيْشِ. Right? So he says that we used to have an imam who would read them together, and he wouldn't separate between them. Amr ibn Maymun, rahimahullah, said that we prayed صلينا المغرب خلف عمر بن الخطاب رضي الله عنه فقرأ في الأولى والتين والزيتون وفي الثانية ألم ترى كيف ولإلاف قريش. We prayed behind عمر رضي الله عنه, and he recited in the first verse سورة التين والتين والزيتون, and in the second surah he recited سورة فيل and قريش. And so they use this as an evidence to say what? That عمر رضي الله عنه considered them to be one surah. But on closer inspection, right, and further analysis, just because you read two surahs in one rak'ah, does that mean that you consider them to be one surah?
They did that when Umar passed away, so the person who led prayed two surahs in that.
Abdul Rahman ibn Awf?
He prayed two surahs.
He read Surah Asr, or was it Kawthar?
Asr was the second rak'ah?
Yeah.
I'm pretty sure he prayed two surahs after he got stabbed.
I don't know. I know he read like Surah Asr or Surah Kawthar, one of them.
But
whether he read two surahs, I don't know. And I would think that at that time they were trying to shorten the prayer, not prolong it even more.
No, because that's what I remember, that's why I thought.
Okay.
It was a bit weird.
Well, that's something worth checking. So, but just because someone reads two surahs in one rak'ah, it doesn't necessarily mean that they consider it to be one surah, right? Because the Prophet ﷺ often used to read more than one surah in a single rak'ah, right? It's mentioned that he read Baqarah, Ali Imran, and Nisa in one rak'ah, right? And all scholars said that they are all one surah. However, it's something which, you know, which some of the scholars, mention. However, the vast majority of the scholars say that they are two surahs, and what they base this upon is وَبَيْنَهُمَا فَاصِلٌ فِي مُصْحَفِ الْإِمَامِ, that there is a fasil, there is a basmala, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, in the Mus'haf al-Imam. What is the Mus'haf al-Imam? In the books of Tafsir, when you come across this statement, في Mus'haf al-Imam, what does that mean, Mus'haf al-Imam? Mus'haf, you know what Mus'haf means, right? Mus'haf is the Qur'an. What is Mus'haf al-Imam? Who's the Mus'haf al-Imam? Uthman, radiyallahu anhu. The Mus'haf of Uthman is known as Mus'haf Uthman, and it is known as Mus'haf al-Imam. For a bonus point, right? Not that we're doing points, but for a bonus point, why is it called Mus'haf al-Imam? Mus'haf Uthman, okay, it's well known because Uthman radiallahu anhu asked them to compile and so on. Why Mus'haf al-Imam?
Could it be because at that time there was a difference of who should be a Khalifa and whatnot, and just to make him the Imam?
Who?
Between the Khawarij and whatnot, and just to sort of really...
No, this is well before that, right? Uthman became the Khalifa, there's no difference of opinion. And the Khawarij has only come towards like the end of his 30-odd years of Khilafah. Why is it called Mus'haf al-Imam?
Maybe. Is it because it's the one that's followed?
Okay, possibly. But that's not like the... I mean, it is kind of. You're close, but that's not the reason why it's called Mus'haf al-Imam.
Yeah. The first one that's actually written down and put together in right order.
No. Because when it's compiled in the time of Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, it's compiled in the right order. Yeah. Do you have something?
No, that's what I said. Would it, would
are you
going to
say the same thing?
If it was Abu Bakr, they would have put him as Siddiq, and Umar, they would have put him by the title of Uthman, they called him the title of Imam.
They were all Imams though, in their time.
Different titles. Oh, because there is the master copy. Okay, so I mean, those are all like things that are mentioned, but it's actually said that Uthman radiallahu anhu, when he asked the companions to come and gather and compile the Quran, he said to them, Ya Ashabu Muhammad, ijtami'u faktubu linnasi imama. O companions of Muhammad, gather together and write for the people an imam, meaning give them a master copy of the Quran, right? But the word imam itself is something which he said, and so because he called it an imam linguistically means something that you follow, right? Someone that you follow, and that's why the imam in salah is called the imam. And the imam, the leader of the Muslims, is called the imam. So because he used the word imam, it became known as Mus'haf al-Imam. So this is like important, because you will often find Ibn Kathir and others in the books of Tafsir, they often refer to this, right? Because you found this written in Mus'haf al-Imam. Right? And Mus'haf al-Imam is referring to the Mus'haf al-Uthman radiallahu anhu, because every Mus'haf subsequently that comes is copied from the Mus'haf al-Uthman radiallahu anhu. So therefore, more or less after the time of Uthman radiallahu anhu, it becomes more or less an issue of ijma', right? The vast majority of the scholars have accepted that they are two separate surahs, as Imam al-Tabari rahimahullah ta'ala mentions at some length in his tafsir, and he goes on to support that position, that they are two separate surahs. So these two surahs are two separate surahs, Surah Al-Fil and Surah Quraysh. Imam Ibn Kathir rahimahullah ta'ala said, هذه السورة مفصولة عن التي قبلها في المصحف الإمام. This surah is separated from the one that came before it in the Mus'haf of al-Imam, meaning the Mus'haf of Uthman radiallahu anhu, كَتَبُوا بَيْنَهُمَا سَطَرُ بِسْمِ اللَّهِ الرَّحْمَنِ الرَّحِيمِ. They wrote between them on a line, بِسْمِ اللَّهِ الرَّحْمَنِ الرَّحِيمِ, the basmala, وَإِنْ كَانَتْ مُتَعَلِّقَةٌ بِمَا قَبْلَهَا, even though it is closely connected to the surah that comes before it. Right? So in terms of theme, message, you know, in terms of the same things that are being mentioned, it is something which is closely related to the surah which comes before it. So we come to the first verse in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لِإِلَافِ قُرَيْشِ, لِإِلَافِ قُرَيْشِ. And it is read in the qira'ah of Imam Ibn Amir, rahimahullah, was one of the seven famous qurra'ah. Right? Ibn Amir, we said, was from where? Which place? No, from Medina. Ibn Amir.
Baghdad,
no. From Damascus. Ibn Amir al-Dimashqi, from Damascus. He reads it without the ya. So instead of li'ilafi, he reads it without the ya. How would you read it?
Ilafi.
Not Quraysh. We're talking about li'ilafi.
Ilafi.
So without the ya, li'ilafi, you read it لِإِلَافِ, لِإِلَافِ, right? So you don't read the ya. And Abu Ja'far, rahimahullah, was one of the 10, also from the 10 mutawatir qira'at, and Abu Ja'far was from Medina. Abu Ja'far reads it without the ya, without the hamza. So he reads it, not لِإِلَافِ, but لِإِلَافِ, لِإِلَافِ, right? And these are all obviously mutawatir qira'at, right? They are all correct. So you have li'ilafi, 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 right? Those are the three correct recitations of this verse. And then you have a qira'ah shadha, a qira'ah which isn't accepted, doesn't meet the stringent conditions of it being an acceptable recitation, but it's reported that Abdullah ibn Abbas radiyallahu anhuma will not read it in any of those ways, but he would say, La ya'laf Quraysh. La ya'lafa Quraysh. Right? La ya'lafa Quraysh. But this is, as we said, something which is a qira'ah shahada, so it's not a correct opinion. What does it mean, li'ilafi Quraysh? Right, can someone pull up like Quran.com and look at the translations that we have? So if you look at Professor Abdul Hakim, you look at Muhsin Khan, you look at Sahih International, maybe like a couple of others.
For the protection of the Quraysh, Sahih International.
So Sahih International says, for the protection,
for the
okay, not all of them, man. We'll be here all day. Okay, so Muhsin Khan says it is a great grace and protection from Allah for the taming of the Quraysh. Sahih International, for the accustomed security of the Quraysh. Mufti Taqi Uthmani, because of the familiarity of the Quraysh. Professor Abdul Halim, he did this to make the Quraysh feel secure. Right? So we have different translations or different wordings that have been chosen in terms of what it is. Yusuf Ali, for the covenants of security and safeguard enjoyed by the Quraysh. Can you do Pictor, since you've like more or less done everyone else? Where is that? For the taming of Quraysh. Okay. So the first issue is, what does the lamb stand for? In the ilah, the lamb. What is the lamb for? And there are three opinions amongst the scholars of tafsir. Three opinions as to what the lamb is referring to. Right, what kind of lamb is this? The first opinion is that it refers to the previous verse of the last surah. The last verse of the previous surah. So Surah Al-Fil, the last verse is... Come on, guys. I'm sure you guys read the surah in every like prayer. فَجَعَلَهُمْ كَعَصْفٍ مَأْكُولٍ. Right? Allah Azza wa Jalla is speaking about the punishment that was given to the army of the elephants. And Allah Azza wa Jalla mentions how they were destroyed and how they were punished. فَجَعَلَهُمْ كَعَصْفٍ مَأْكُولٍ لِإِلَافِ قُرَيْشٍ. They were made, what's the translation for that? فَجَعَلَهُمْ كَعَصْفٍ مَأْكُولٍ. Sorry?
So he rendered them like straw eaten?
Eaten up? Okay. So he rendered them like straw eaten up, right? Like chewed straw. لِإِلَافِ قُرَيْشِ, for the benefit of Quraysh, right? For the security of Quraysh, for the blessing that he bestowed upon Quraysh. So do you understand? That's the first position amongst the scholars of Islam. The lamb, which is the four, refers to what is being mentioned in the previous surah, right? And obviously those scholars, some of them must have probably been on the position, like Abdul Rahman ibn Zayd ibn Aslam and others, that the two surahs were perhaps connected. But Imam al-Shawkani rahimahullah, from the scholars of tafsir, also championed this view, that the lamb refers to the previous surah. So the two surahs are very closely connected in terms of theme. So Allah Azza wa Jalla is reminding them of the benefits that they were given, and then he says, لِإِلَافِ قُرَيْشِ, this was for the benefits, for the security, for the safety of the people of Quraysh. And no doubt, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he destroys the army of the elephants, it is done as a favor and as a blessing and for the security and safety of Quraysh, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saves them. Why? Because what happens if Abraha is successful and he destroys the Kaaba and he destroys Mecca? What happens to Quraysh? Most likely, they will be weakened, number one. What else? In those days when people would come and they would destroy a city, what would happen to the people?
Enslaved.
Enslaved, which means that they are therefore dispersed. Right? They are spread out. Right? They're no longer the people of Quraysh in Mecca. But they have now been exiled from their land, or it's no longer worthy of inhabiting, or it's no longer a place where they can reside. So they leave, or they're enslaved and their people are killed and so on. And so they begin to spread out. Right? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is reminding them of that favor. So this was the opinion of Abdul Rahman ibn Zayd ibn Aslam. Right? Abdul Rahman ibn Zayd ibn Aslam is a famous scholar of tafsir, I think from the second or the third century, or the second or third generation. Who is Aslam, his grandfather? Abdul Rahman ibn Zayd ibn Aslam. Aslam is the freed slave of Umar radiallahu anhu. And Zayd ibn Aslam is the son of Aslam. Abdul Rahman ibn Zayd is his grandson. Right? So Abdul Rahman ibn Zayd ibn Aslam is a well-known name that you will find in the books of tafsir. And as we said, Imam al-Shawkani, rahimahullah, also championed this view. The second opinion, or the second view amongst the scholars of tafsir, and this is the one that's mentioned by Al-Khalid ibn Ahmad, who's the famous grammarian and linguist of the Arabic language, and from the scholars of tafsir by Al-Tahir ibn Ashur, rahimahumullah, they said that the lam refers to what comes afterwards in the surah. And that is the verse in which Allah Azza wa Jal says, فَلْيَعْبُدُوا رَبَّ هَذَا الْبَيْتِ. So let them then worship the Lord of this house. So Allah Azza wa Jal is saying that Allah has given them blessing and safety and security. For what reason? For the security of Quraysh, right? For what? So that they can worship Him. So Allah Azza wa Jal gave them these blessings so that they would be able to spend their time worshipping Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. Right? And that's the opinion of, as we said, Ibn Ashur and others from amongst the scholars of tafsir. And then you have a third opinion, and it's reported that this is the opinion of Abdullah ibn Abbas radiyallahu anhuma, and it is the position that Imam al-Tabari rahimahullah chooses, and the one that he champions, and the one that he pushes, and the one that he says is the strongest of the opinions of tafsir, and that is that it is lam al-ta'ajjub, a lam to show amazement and wonder. That Allah Azza wa Jalla is saying li'ilafi Quraysh, how amazing is the situation of Quraysh. Why is their situation amazing? This is what the ilaf is referring to, right? And why you have differences of opinion amongst the scholars of tafsir as to what ilaf refers to. But Imam al-Tabri rahimahullah, going back to just the lam, that letter lam, he says that it is lam al-ta'ajjub, and it was a common way of the Arabs expressing their amazement and their wonder at something, that they would add the lam into, and he mentions obviously verses of poetry and so on as they do, to show that this was something common in the Arabic language. That it is lam al-ta'ajjub. So you're not connecting it to the verse before, nor are you connecting it to the verses that will come afterwards in the same surah, but rather it is a lam to show amazement and wonder at the situation of Quraysh, and the blessings that Allah Azza wa Jal bestowed upon them, and the favors that they were granted by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So it is lam al-ta'ajjub, right? And this is the opinion of Al-Imam al-Tabari rahimahullahu ta'ala. قال ابن جرير رحمه الله والصواب أن اللام لام التعجب كأنه يقول اعجبوا لإلاف قريش ونعمة عليهم في ذلك. So ابن جرير رحمه الله الطبري said the correct opinion is that the lam is the lam of amazement and wonder, as if Allah Azza wa Jalla is saying, are you not amazed at the blessings that were given to Quraysh and the ilaf that was given to them. قال وذلك لإجماع المسلمين على أنهما سورتان منفصلتان مستقلتان. And that's because the scholars of Islam have agreed unanimously that these are two completely independent surahs. So he's dismissing which opinion? The first opinion, that says that it's connected to the last verse of the previous surah. He says because that opinion is based on those two surahs being one, right, and the same. However, he says that there is ijma, right, consensus amongst the scholars that they are two separate surahs. Why is he saying there's consensus when we said that there were scholars who differed over this? Ubay ibn Ka'ab and others.
Is the position is Shad?
Which position is Shad?
The one that says it's one surah.
Okay, so that it's not a Shad. Yeah, it's like a rare opinion, or it's like not a common opinion.
Because that's
what something which was accepted by the Mus'haf after the time of Uthman radiallahu anhu. Once his Mus'haf is accepted by the Muslim Ummah and is spread, and that's what they consider to be the Mus'haf, then it's more or less an issue of consensus amongst the scholars of Islam. And that's why you don't really find, after maybe perhaps that statement of Sufyan ibn Uyayna rahimahullah and others of that time, which is like third generation of Islam, you don't really find any mention of scholars who said that they were two separate surahs, right? And so they consider them to be, that they were one single surah, but they consider them to be two separate surahs. So that's the lam, right? So for the lam, how many opinions do we have? Three opinions. The first opinion is that it refers to the previous surah. The second opinion is that it refers to the third verse, right? فَلْيَعْبُدُوا رَبَّ هَذَا الْبَيْتِ. And the third opinion is that the lam is التعجب, to show amazement and to show wonder. إلاف. What does the word إلاف mean? Shaykh Muhammad al-Amin al-Shanqiti rahimahullah ta'ala said the word إلاف can have a couple of possible meanings. The first of them is that it comes from ta'lif. And that means that they were united. That Allah Azza wa Jalla kept Quraysh together, kept them united, kept them together as one. And Allah Azza wa Jalla, therefore, when He's saying li ilafi Quraysh, He's saying for, I think that is the translation that you get for the taming of Quraysh, right? That they have always remained together as a strong family and as a strong bond, right? They have a strong bond between themselves. Why? Because that was rare in the time of Jahiliyyah, before Islam. It was rare amongst Arab tribes that they would live like the Quraysh did, all together in peace and security, not fighting with one another and not fearing one another in a single location. It's rare. Because amongst the Arabs it was common that they would fight one another, that they would have civil strife amongst one another, that sometimes even kin and kith that were from the same kind of tribes, but then they lived in the same locality, they would fight one another. And perhaps the most famous example of this is the people of Medina, right? The Aus and the Khazraj, before the Prophet ﷺ came, were constantly fighting one another. They had civil war between them, even though both of them live in the same city. That was common amongst the Arabs. So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that that Allah Azza wa Jalla li'ilafi, right, He gave them, He made them united, He brought them together. And they would agree, even in terms of their leaders, who they would honor, who they would respect, and so on. And this is something which comes over time, over and over again. Happens, for example, before the time of the Prophet ﷺ, happens in the time of Abdul Muttalib when he discovers Zamzam, happens before that in the time of his great-grandfather Hashim. In those different periods of the history of Quraysh, there are potential points in which they could have dispersed, they could have fought, they could have separated, they could have disunited, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala always kept them together as a single group. Allah Azza wa Jalla always kept them united under a single leadership and so on. And that was something rare in the time of Jahiliyyah, before the time of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And that's why Allah Azza wa Jalla reminds them of this favor in the Quran. And that's why the scholars said, those scholars like At-Tabari rahimahullah and others, they said that the lam is for ta'ajjub, it's for amazement and wonder, because the situation of Quraysh is unique to them amongst the Arabs. So when Allah Azza wa Jalla is saying the ilafi Quraysh, it's not because of one incident like the feed, that's only one example of what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did for them. They say that the lam is much more general, right? Much wider, much broader. It encompasses everything that Allah gave to them. And from them is this blessing that they always kept together, united as a single tribe, and they never had any of that internal strife. And that doesn't mean, by the way, they didn't have, you know, people competing with one another, they didn't have people who tried to up each other and so on, because we know that there were certain clans amongst them that always tried to better the other clans. But it never led to, we never went so far as to lead to internal warfare and internal strife. So that's the first opinion. And then he says, rahimahullah, Shaykh Shanqiti, rahimahullah, or it could be min al-ilfi wa ta'awud, or it could be from becoming accustomed to something. And that is being accustomed to, as we will mention in the second verse, rihlat al-shita'i was-sayf, the traveling that they would do for commerce and business in the summer months and in the winter months to Sham and to Yemen, and how it became easy for them. And no doubt that from the greatest blessings that Allah bestowed upon Quraysh is that Quraysh became the center of Arabia. Mecca and the Quraysh became the center of Arabia. By virtue of them having the Kaaba, the role of the Arabs honored and revered and they glorified, but also because they then became the commercial capital of the Arabian Peninsula. And that's also from the blessings that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave to them, and we will mention this in more detail when we come to the second verse. So what is Allah Azza wa Jalla therefore reminding them about? What is this, what is this ni'mah, or what is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying to us that we should be amazed by? What is it that is so wonderful about Quraysh? What is this wondrous thing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave to them? Some of the scholars like Ibn Abbas and others said that it is all of the ni'mas that Allah gave to them, all of the blessings that Allah bestowed upon them. And others said, like Al-Hasan al-Basri, it is the blessing of giving them the Kaaba and giving them the custodianship of the Haram and the Kaaba. And others said it is this ability to do commerce and trade and to travel in the months of the summer and the months of the winter, to Ash-Sham and to Yemen. And no doubt, you know, to combine and reconcile between all of those opinions, they are all examples of the different blessings that Allah gave to them. And all of them come under that same banner of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's blessings that He bestowed upon them. Al-Imam Al-Qurtubi rahimahullah ta'ala said in his tafsir that we have done this, meaning that we did what we did with the people, of, with the army of the elephant, we destroyed them as a blessing for Quraysh. As a blessing for Quraysh and as a favor over Quraysh. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, li'ilafi. Right, so either for the security or for the blessing or for the taming, all of those different translations that we had, all of them come to what is the meaning of the word ilaf. For the blessings that Allah bestowed and the grace that Allah azza wa jal gave to Quraysh by making them safe and making them united and making them a single entity, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, we gave this to Quraysh. Who are Quraysh? Who are Quraysh? Quraysh is the tribe of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But where does Quraysh come from? Okay, so the nasab or the lineage of Quraysh goes back to which Prophet? Ismail alayhi salam, and therefore the Prophet Ibrahim alayhi salam. Right? And from him you have all of the descendants of Quraysh. The Prophet said sallallahu alayhi wasallam in the hadith in Sahih al-Bukhari and Muslim, Inna Allah astafa kinana min waladi Ismail. واصطفى من بني كنانة قريش قريشا واصطفى من قريش بني هاشم واصطفاني من بني هاشم. Allah chose Kinana from all of the children of Ismail, and from Kinana He chose Quraysh, and from Quraysh He chose Banu Hashim, and from Banu Hashim He chose me. And this is the hadith in Al-Bukhari and Muslim. The question therefore is, when does Quraysh begin as the tribe? Right? Obviously they go back all the way to Ibrahim and Ismail alayhi salam. In this hadith, the Prophet is saying from the children of Ismail, Allah chose who? Kinana. And from Kinana, He chose Quraysh. So therefore, who is Quraysh? Some of the scholars said that Quraysh is the son of Kinana and his name is An-Nadr. An-Nadr ibn Kinana. And he is known sometimes as Al-Quraysh Al-Akbar. Right? The major Quraysh or the big Quraysh. Like everyone that's from the tribe of Quraysh takes back their lineage to this man, An-Nadr ibn Kinana, and that's what the Prophet ﷺ is saying, that Allah chose from Kinana Quraysh. Right? He chose Quraysh. So his name is An-Nadr ibn Kinana. And others said it is Fahr ibn Malik. Fahr ibn Malik, who is the great grandfather of the Prophet. What number? 12th, his 12th, I think his 12th great-grandfather. So the 12th great-grandfather of the Prophet ﷺ is Fahr ibn Malik. What is it? 10th. 10, right. So another ibn Kinana is number 12, right? And Fahr ibn Malik is number 10. Fahr ibn Malik is the 10th great-grandfather of the Prophet ﷺ, and he is sometimes known as Quraysh. He is known as Quraysh, or he is known as sometimes Al-Quraysh Al-Awsat, the middle Quraysh. If Nadr ibn Kinana is the big Quraysh, he is known as the middle Quraysh. Why is he known as the middle Quraysh?
He's another person
who is known as Quraysh, but why? Like, how do we reconcile between them? Those scholars who said that Nadr ibn Kinana, he is who all of Quraysh comes from. And that is the opinion, by the way, of the Jamhur. The majority of the scholars and the majority of the genealogists say Quraysh comes from this man, a man by the name of An-Nadr ibn Kinana. Others said it comes from Fahr ibn Malik, and I think that was the opinion of, I think, Ibn Abdul Bar, Ibn Hazm, some of the scholars. And the way that you reconcile between them is that Fahr ibn Malik was the only descendant of Nadr ibn Kinana to have children. So from his grandson's line, all of the children come from Fahr ibn Malik. So you can reconcile in the sense that Fahr ibn Malik, everyone comes through his line anyway. So therefore, there's no real contradiction between those two statements, right? So that's where Quraysh begins, and this is now, we're talking about the 10th and the 12th great-grandfather of our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It is said that Quraysh is obviously a big tribe, therefore all of the descendants of these people become Quraysh. But the Quraysh of Mecca, or the Quraysh that lived in and around the Kaaba, right, what are known as the Quraysh al-Batha, the city dwellers of Quraysh, they are from the descendants of Qusay ibn Kilab.
Usay ibn Kilab is the
sixth.
The sixth great grandfather of the Prophet. Right? The sixth great grandfather of the Prophet. Why is he considered, and he's known as Quraysh al Asghar, the small Quraysh. Why? Because he was the one who settled all of his family in Mecca. And he forced the other tribes that lived in Mecca that weren't from his family, meaning from his part of Quraysh, to go to the outskirts of Mecca. He kind of pushed them out. He was the leader of his time. And it is said that during his time, he was the one that would be in charge of the upkeep of the Kaaba. And he would be in charge of the watering of the pilgrims. And he was the one who was in charge of the administration and the politics. And he was the one who would have the flag of war and everything. Everything kind of came back to this one individual, Qusay ibn Kilab.
I think it's the fourth.
Is it the fourth?
Fourth grandfather. So you've got Muhammad ibn Abdullah, ibn Abdul Muttalib, ibn Hashim, ibn Abdul Manaf, ibn Qusay. And then you carry on from this. So that would be the fourth.
So that's his fifth
grandfather. So Abdul Muttalib.
Abdullah, Abdul Muttalib, Hashim, Abd Manaf, and then Qusay. Right? So five generations above the Prophet. So he's the one who settled in Mecca. And then Mecca, all of his family came, and all of his descendants became from the descendants of Mecca. And that's why all of the Quraysh were relatives, right? They were all related to one another, and they were all cousins and what have you. So Quraysh, the Prophet ﷺ mentioned a number of hadith concerning the virtues of Quraysh. We mentioned one of them in the hadith in Bukhari and Muslim, that Allah chose Quraysh from the children of Ismail, and Banu Hashim from Quraysh, and me from Banu Hashim. And then the hadith that is collected in the Muslim of Imam Ahmad, rahimahullah ta'ala, and the authority of Aisha radiallahu anha, that the Prophet said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he entered upon her one day, lawla an tabtara Quraysh lakhbartuha bima laha inda Allahi azza wa jal. Were it not that Quraysh would become arrogant and haughty, I would tell them of their status in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I would tell them of their status in the sight of Allah azza wa jal. And know that it is part of our religion that Quraysh have a virtue and they have a certain position within this religion. In the hadith of Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu that is collected in Al-Bukhari and Muslim, the Prophet said sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, "An-nasu taba'un li Quraysh fi hadha al-sha'n, muslimuhum taba' li muslimihim, wa kafiruhum taba'un li kafirihim." The people are followers of Quraysh in this affair. The Muslims follow the Muslims and the disbelievers follow the disbelievers. Meaning in which affair? The people are followers of Quraysh in this affair.
The religion.
No, not the religion. Because it says the Muslims follow the Muslims and non-Muslims follow the non-Muslims. In leadership. Right? And that's why when the Prophet ﷺ passed away, and Abu Bakr and Umar and Abu Ubaidah ibn Jarrah radiallahu anhum came to the place where the Ansar were gathering, and they were discussing who would take the Khilafah, and they were deciding amongst themselves, you know, who's going to be the Khalifa? Is it me? Is it you? Who is it that's going to be the Khalifa? What did Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu say to them? He said that this is something which has to be in Quraysh. Right? The people will only follow the leadership of Quraysh. And that was true before Islam. Because the other Arab tribes looked up to and they revered Quraysh and so on. And that's why, remember, we mentioned in the tafsir of Surah Al-Nasr, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَرَأَيْتَ النَّاسَ يَدْخُلُونَ فِي دِينِ اللَّهِ أَفْوَاجًا. And when you see the people entering into the religion of Allah in droves, in multitudes, in great and vast numbers, there is a narration in which it is said that the people were waiting to see what Quraysh will do. So if Quraysh enter into Islam, the people would follow them. And that's why when Quraysh were conquered and they accepted Islam in the 8th year, the following year, the 9th year, is known as Amul Wufud, the year of delegations, because all of the different Arab tribes came from across the peninsula to the Prophet ﷺ in Medina, and they gave him the pledge of allegiance and they accepted Islam. So that is also from the virtues of Quraysh. In another hadith, also in Bukhari and Muslim, on the authority of Ibn Umar radiallahu anhuma, that the Prophet said sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, la yazalu hadha al-amru fi Quraysh ma baqiya minhum uthnan. This affair will always continue to be in Quraysh so long as there are two from amongst them, meaning the Khilafah, right? Leadership and the Khilafah will stay in Quraysh. And that's why in Sahih Bukhari, when Uthman radiallahu an was compiling the Mus'haf, and he bought Zayd ibn Thabit radiallahu an and his
two or three other companions with them, he said to them, إِذَا اخْتَلَفْتُمْ أَنْتُمْ وَزَيْدِ بْنُ ثَابِتٍ فِي شَيْءٍ مِنَ الْقُرْآنِ فَاكْتُبُوهُ بِلِسَانِ قُرَيْشِ فَإِنَّمَا نَزَلَ بِلِسَانِهِمْ. Right, he has Abdullah ibn Zubayr along with Zayd ibn Thabit and was Sa'id ibn al-As, I think, and Abdul Rahman ibn al-Harith, a number of companions, four of them. Their job is to compile the Mus'haf. Zayd ibn Thabit is from where? Which tribe?
From Medina.
He's from the Ansar. Zayd ibn Thabit is from the Ansar, but he's one of the most knowledgeable companions concerning the Quran. And the other three are from where? From Quraysh, from Mecca. So he's saying to them, إِذَا اخْتَلَفْتُمْ أَنْتُمْ وَزَيْدِ ibn Thabit, if you three and Zayd differ as to the writing of the Quran, its script, فِي شَيْءٍ مِنَ الْقُرْآنِ فَاكْتُبُوهُ بِلِسَانِ Quraysh, then write it according to the tongue of Quraysh. Meaning that if Zayd ibn Thabit says one thing, you three say another thing, you differ, write it the way that you would write it amongst Quraysh. فَإِنَّمَا نَزَلَ بِلِسَانِهِمْ, because the Quran was revealed amongst Quraysh. Meaning it was revealed to the Prophet ﷺ, who is from Quraysh. Right? And that is also in Sahih Bukhari, and it also shows the virtue of the tribe of Quraysh. Any questions? Sorry, his first child born in Medina. Yeah, after the Hijra, yes.
When you say now, for this child, Zayd,
sorry, say that again.
You say the hadith, you say take this for persona for the tafsir, for the.
He's compiling the Quran. Yeah, I think so, yeah. From what I remember. Abdullah ibn Zubayr minhum. Yeah, he's young. But from the time of Uthman radiallahu anhu, this is in the time of Uthman, not in the time of the Prophet. Yeah, in the time of Uthman, he's not young anymore. Yeah, he's a grown man, and he's also one of the most learned companions in that time. Remember, in the time of Uthman, many of the senior companions have passed away.
Yeah.
I have a question here from Yusuf. Why is studying the lineage of the Prophet important? It's important because, you know, studying anything about the life of the Prophet is part of our study of the seerah and the life of the Prophet. And that is important, right? It's part of our religion to learn about our Prophet, to know him, to know who he's from, and his parents, and his lineage, and his tribe, and his wives, and his children, and everything about the Prophet. It is part of our religion, and it is one of the signs that show our love for our Prophet. And therefore, it is something which, you know, the scholars have always done from the time of the companions until our time. Any other questions?
Why so much emphasis has been given? Is there a combined surah or is it different set? Like, what's the point of view that scholars has put into it? Like, why so much emphasis has been given if it's a combined surah or it's a different surah? How does it change our point of view about this level?
It doesn't really change our point of view in terms of. So the question is whether the surahs and Quraysh are one surah, a combined surah, whether they're two separate surahs. Why is that important? Right? Why is that like such an important thing to study? It's not important in terms of, it doesn't make a practical difference to anything in terms of the Quran is still the Quran, is still the same number of verses, still everything. However, there is, you will see a difference in terms of the counting of the surahs. Because the surahs no longer then become 114, now they become 113, right? And similar to that is the difference of opinion amongst the scholars as to whether Anfal and Tawbah are one surah, or whether they are two separate surahs. Because Tawbah has no basmala, right? It has no basmala. There's like, you know, in any mushaf, it's just not written with the basmala. Therefore, is it a surah along with Anfal? And that's why when you hear the scholars say the Sab'u Tiwal, you know, when they speak about the classical way that they would section the Quran, they would say that the first part of the Quran is the Sab'u Tiwal, the seven long surahs. What are the seven long surahs? Baqarah, Ali Imran, An-Nisa, Ma'idah, An'am, A'raf, Anfal, and Tawbah. The Sab'u Tiwal includes Tawbah. Right? And then the others only start from Hud onwards. So Anfal and Tawbah are mentioned together. And so why are they mentioned together? Are they one surah or two separate surahs? Even those scholars who say they are two separate surahs will say, because there's no basmala between them, you just say that they're seven. Right? And seven is a nice number amongst the Arabs, they like the number seven. So they said the seven qiwal. So there is a difference of opinion over some surahs. So you will find differences of opinion over these issues in classical works. However, you know, after a certain period in history, the Muslim Ummah more or less agreed. Like today, if you were to ask any Muslim how many surahs in the Quran, you'll get one standard answer, which is 114. Right? Just as there is a difference of opinion among scholars and in the different qira'at as to the number of verses in the Quran. Right? Because if you go to the different qira'at, they have stops where in other surahs you don't have stops. Right? And we mentioned this. Did we mention this? I don't know if we mentioned this. In Surah Fatiha, did we mention this? Yeah, very briefly we touched upon this, right? So, is the basmala, when we spoke about the basmala, right? Is the basmala a verse of surah, of surah? Because we know the hadith says, how many verses in Surah Fatiha?
Seven.
Seven. Right? Sab'ul mathani is the seven oft-repeated verses. So there have to be seven. So if you include the basmala within that, then where? How do you do the seven? Right? So some of them will say, Sirat al-ladhi amta alayhim ghayr maghdubi alayhim al-dalin is one verse. And others who don't include the basmala will say, Sirat al-ladhin lamta alayhim. It's a verse. غَيْرُ الْمَغْضُوبِ عَلَيْهِمْ الْضَالِينَ is another verse. So you have these differences, you know, and this is like one of those sciences. It's called عِلْمُ عَدِّ الْآيِ. The science of counting the number of verses. And you'll find, you know, like in the classical works of Quranic studies and the science of the Quran, this is something which they would pay attention to. Right? And that's why if you go to the Mus'haf of Medina, you know, the Mus'haf that they print in Saudi Arabia, and you go to the back, I don't know if they have one here, but if you go to the back of the Mus'haf, they have like those 3-4 pages in Arabic that speak about how they the work that they did in making sure that the Quran is authentic and it's done in the way that's correct according to all of the scholars of tafsir and all of these different sciences of Quran. And they will mention that these are the different sciences that we looked at, including Adul Ay and Rasam and Dabt, which was script, and qira'at, and all of those different sciences of the Qur'an which have now become rare forms of study. They mention all of them because it is part and parcel of making sure that the Mus'haf is authentic and it's correct and it's done in the way that Uthman radiyallahu anh united the Ummah upon. Any other questions? What time is Isha?
Quarter past.
So you know, so the question is the last verse or the first verse of Surah Al-Nahl and the previous verse of the Surah Al-Hijr, وَعْبُدْ رَبَّكَ حَتَّى يَأْتِيَكَ الْيَقِينَ. Worship your Lord until certainty comes to you. And then Allah says, أَتَى أَمْرُ اللَّهِ. The command of Allah has come. Is there not a connection between them? This is also another, you know, like another discussion amongst the scholars of the order of the surahs of the Quran. Is it tawqifi or is it ijtihadi? Meaning, are the ordering of the surahs of the Quran, was it something dictated by the Prophet ﷺ, or was it something which the companions did later on by ijtihad? No doubt that those that tartib, that ordering of the surahs now has become an issue of ijma', right? The ummah has accepted this and it's become an issue of consensus. But who put the ordering of the surahs in that way? Was it something which the Prophet ﷺ did? And you have those scholars who say, yes, it's from the Prophet ﷺ in that last year when Jibril alayhi salam came in Ramadan and revised the Quran twice with the Prophet ﷺ. He gave him the ordering of the surahs and he told him which verses go in which surahs and so on. So the Quran was complete from beginning to end during that final year of the Prophet ﷺ's life. And therefore, he's the one who puts that tartib. And so one of the other sciences of the Quran is something called ilmul munasabat. Right, munasabat means the science of relationship. The relationship between different surahs and the relationship between different verses within a surah. Why does, when Allah Azza wa Jalla change from one theme to another, one story to another, what is the connection between them? What is the connection between Baqarah and Ali Imran? Ali Imran and Nisa and Ma'ida. How do they all continue? Those scholars who say therefore that there is this science, ilmul munasabat, and that the ordering of the surahs is tawqifi, it's something which the Prophet ﷺ did, they will tell you that this is the reason why. Right? So this is the connection between Surah Al-Hijr and Surah Al-Nahl, between Surah Fil and Surah Quraysh. Right? And sometimes it's very obvious, like Surah Fil and Quraysh is a very obvious connection. Surah Falaq and Nas, as we mentioned, is a slightly obvious connection. But other times it's not so clear, and it's not so easy to make that connection. Another scholar said, no, it's something which the companions did. And there are some scholars who don't even really hold this science of munasabat to be a real science of the Qur'an. Right? They consider it more to be, you know, a form of contemplation of the Qur'an, but it's not really a science because it's not something which, you know, comes from that time of the Prophet ﷺ. Either way, you know, that's like a whole different discussion. But there is no doubt that there are, you know, especially in some of the ordering of these surahs, there is a clear connection in terms of theme and in terms of moving on from one to another. And if you look at some of those works of munasabat and how different surahs relate to different surahs, you will find, you know, it's amazing in terms of, even if you just say it's contemplation of the Qur'an, it is amazing to understand the connection or to see how those scholars made connections between these different surahs. And Allah knows best. Okay. And Imam Al-Qurtubi, rahimahullah ta'ala, said, and we're still speaking about Quraysh here, in the first verse. And Imam Al-Qurtubi, rahimahullah ta'ala, mentions what Quraysh means. What is the meaning of the word Quraysh? Right? What does it mean and where does it come from? He said, وَاخْتُلِفَ فِي تَسْمِيَتِهِمْ قُرَيْشًا عَلَىٰ أَقْوَالٍ. He said that they differed over the reason why Quraysh is called Quraysh and what it refers to. He said the first of them, those opinions, is that they, because of them being united, they were called Quraysh because التقرش in the Arabic language means to be united. So Quraysh comes from the word تقرش, which means to be united. And therefore they were known as Quraysh because they were constantly united. The second opinion is لأنهم كانوا تجارا يأكلون من مكاسبهم, because they were known to be businessmen, trading people, who used to eat from the wealth that they would earn from their trade. And التقرش التكسب. And from the meanings of Quraysh, or التقرش is to earn, right? To make money from business. So they became known as Quraysh, and this was the opinion of Al-Farra from the linguists, who said that it was because of their trade that they became known and their business dealings that they became known as Quraysh. The third opinion, it is said because from the root word of Quraysh is the meaning of searching. Right? Searching. And that's because when the people of Hajj used to come for Hajj, they would search them. Right? One of the practices of Quraysh in the Hajj was that if you were a person who came from outside of Mecca, outside of Quraysh, and you came into Mecca, you had to pay to buy new cloth from the haram that you would dress yourself in order to make tawaf. Right? This was one of the practices that they had. So if you came from outside of Mecca and you came into Mecca, like today when we go for ihram, right? You go to Mecca, you perform umrah, you wear ihram. In their time, their version of that, I suppose, was that if you come from outside of Mecca, you must buy clothing from Mecca, from them, new clothing that you wear yourself, you drape yourself with, and then you go and make tawaf. However, as we know, the vast majority of Arabs were what? Were poor. Right? They would have only one, you know, like one set of clothing that they would use for years. They weren't people who used to buy new clothes on Eid and whatever. They didn't have the wealth, they didn't have money. Most of them were extremely poor. And many of them, even in the time of the Prophet ﷺ after Islam, only used to have one sheet that they would cover themselves with. So they would use it as an izar, as a lower robe, and they often didn't have anything to cover the top of themselves with, right? The upper robe or the top robe, they didn't have any clothing for their chest and their shoulders. And that's because of how poor they were, the Muslims as well, after Islam. But before Islam, many of them were also poor. So when they said that we can't afford to buy clothing from you, to buy cloth, and to make tawaf in it, what was their answer? To make tawaf naked. If you can't buy it from us, and that's where the tawaf naked comes from. Comes from this stringent condition that they placed upon them. So one of the things it is said that they used to do when people used to come to Mecca is that they would search them to see if they have the wealth to which to buy new cloth, or if they have new cloth with them that they bought, that they could go and make make tawaf with. And this was, by the way, one of the ways, and you know the hadith that we mentioned, the Prophet ﷺ said, were not that Quraysh would become haughty and arrogant, I would tell them of their position in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It comes from this kind of stuff, because the Quraysh became arrogant and proud because of their position of being the custodians of the Kaaba and the Haram. So for example, when the people used to go to Arafah, right, to make in Hajj, when they would go to Arafah, the Quraysh would refuse to go to Arafah. And they would say, because Arafah is outside of the Haram boundary, only the non-Qurashis, the people that have come from outside of the Haram, have to go to Arafah. As for us, we are the people of the Haram, so we only need to stay in the Haram. Right? And that's why when the Prophet ﷺ made the Hajj, what did he call Arafah? He called it the greatest pillar of Hajj, right? Al-Hajju Arafah. Hajj is Arafah. To show how, you know, incorrect the understanding was of the Hajj. So they had these practices, and it was to show that they are better, right? It is said, for example, that the Kaaba, in its original form, was at ground level, right? Because the Quran, the Kaaba today is raised, right? Obviously, the door is raised, and you know, if you want to go in, they have these mobile steps and staircase that they bring out. They attach it to the doorway, and they climb the stairs to get into the Kaaba. It is said it is the Quraysh who raised the floor of the Kaaba in the time of Ibrahim alayhi salam. In the early days, the Kaaba was at ground level, right, only slightly raised, like a step or so. It wasn't something which you had to go and climb a whole staircase to get up to. But the Quraysh did that to stop others from entering into the Kaaba without their permission. They raised it so that others couldn't just come in and walk into the Kaaba when they wanted, because this is our honor, it belongs to us, we are Quraysh. So they had these types of, you know, this type of thinking that led them to certain, you know, haughtiness and pride and arrogance that they displayed. So this was an example of that. And one of the things that they would do is when people come for Hajj or for Umrah from outside of the Haram, from outside of Mecca, they're not from Quraysh, they would force them to buy new cloth. And in the vast majority of cases, when they could not and they didn't have the wealth to be able to do so, they would tell them to make the tawaf naked. And that's why it is said the Prophet ﷺ, when Hajj was obligated in the ninth year of the Hijrah, he chose not to go in the first year. Instead, he sent Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, and then later on he sent Ali radiallahu anhu with additional information, additional, you know, like rulings and so on, to eradicate these practices of Jahiliyyah. Otherwise, if the Prophet ﷺ is doing it, people may become confused. They don't know what is Islam, not Islam. They still have practices of pre-Islam going on during the Hajj period. So Abu Bakr was sent radiallahu anhu, and he was made the leader of the Hajj that first year, and he stopped all of those practices. And he told the people, you can't make tawaf naked, and he destroyed the idols, and he destroyed their practices, and so on and so forth. And then the following year, in the 10th year of the Hijrah, the Prophet ﷺ went himself, and he made the tawaf, he made the Hajj. So this is the third opinion, right? That it was because of this searching, and this is also from the meanings of the root word of Quraysh, and therefore it is that was the reason. The fourth opinion is what is reported, that Muawiyah radiallahu anhu asked Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma, لِمَ سُمِّيَتْ قُرَيْشٌ قُرَيْشًا, why was Quraysh called Quraysh? And he said it's because of a sea animal, a predator in the sea that is known as the strongest predator in the sea. It eats and beats everything that comes into it, before it. تَأْكُلُ وَلَا تُؤْكَلْ, it eats and it is not eaten. تَعْلُ وَلَا تُعْلَى, and it is the one that always wins and it is never beaten. And because Quraysh became the premier tribe amongst the Arabs, they were the ones who were considered the most honorable and everything else, they became known as the Quraysh, and that name was taken from that sea animal. What that sea animal is, I honestly don't know if it's referring to a shark or a whale or something else. I'm not quite sure exactly what it's referring to. But it's said that that's what it is referring to, and Allah Azza wa Jal knows best. Okay, I think we'll stop there, inshallah ta'ala. I have a question here about the numbering of ayat. Is there any difference of opinion about numbering those at the end of Surah Ali Imran? Ibn Abbas said that the Prophet ﷺ recited the last 10 ayat when he woke up for Salah at night, and this refers to the last 11, or is this rounded down, or a manner of speech? That's something which I'll have to go back and check. I'm not quite sure from the top of my head. But there is no doubt that there is a difference amongst the scholars concerning the number of verses of certain surahs, not every surah, but certain surahs of the Quran. And inshallah, our class timings, inshallah, next week at the same time now?
Not next week, is that 20 minutes?
So next week Maghrib was going to be around like 7:20-ish, maybe. So then the class will start about 20 minutes after. So 7:40, or actually it's online, 7:40 next week, and then 7:20, and then 7:05, and then it goes and changes time in October. So inshallah we'll be back next week. Any questions before we conclude? Okay, جزاكم الله خيرا وصلى على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين.
Friday,
Friday.
Friday.
Oh, yeah.
Okay. Allah.